This is Mooney's Pub in Dublin. To many people, this is Ireland, convivial and garrulous. But as with so many generalities in all countries, this is half truth, half myth. What is the real Ireland? What are its problems and its accomplishments, its aims and its frustrations? How close to the real Irishman is America's image of him? Today we present the first of two episodes, especially filmed in Ireland by the 20th century. Ireland, the Tear and the Smile, as the Prudential Insurance Company of America presents the 20th century. O'Connell Street march Irish troops, off to join the UN forces in the Congo. Symbol of Ireland's coming of international age. Neutral in World War II, unaffiliated today, although pro-West ideologically, Ireland pursues an independent course in the UN, along with the other small nation neutrals, for discussing the admission of Red China, for Algerian, African, and Tibetan self-determination, against anything that smacks of colonialism. This is its army's first assignment beyond its own borders, under its own flag. For some, it will be the last. Some will die in action there. This is Dublin, a city of contrast, its streets alive with cars, horse-drawn wagons, buses. But seldom are Dubliners too busy for a reflective pause by the River Liffey. Life is leisurely, casual, fanciful. Who can be prompt when city streets double as cow paths? There is a theory that civilization came up from the south and east with Ireland at the end of the queue. One explanation for why it has stood so long outside the mainstream of history. Yet the Irish literary tradition has always burned bright. Wilde, Congreve, Swift, Sheridan, Joyce, Goldsmith, O'Casey, Shaw, fired to splendid language, have all flourished, but not at home. Why do they leave Ireland, these men of vision and originality? This reporter asked playwright Brendan Behan, one who has stayed.
Bernard Shaw said one time about London and Dublin that he preferred the city that he conquered, the one that very nearly conquered him.
Well, Dublin is a much different place to... I think James Joyce, he said about it one time, somebody asked him, when was he going back to Dublin? And he said, when have I ever left it? I think that Joyce was correct. I think it is true to say about Dublin that it is a city in the way that London and Paris even are not. A city is a sort of a place which is large enough for to have a lot of independent lives, and at the same time small enough for a great number of the people to know who is being alluded to, usually in a scurrilous fashion. I knew a man who was a teetotaler, and he drank 40 bottles of orange juice one time in a public house in Dublin called Davy Burns. And I said, "Why did you want to drink 40 bottles of orange juice?" Well, he said, "I had to drink something. I was there for 12 hours. Well, I said, "Why did you want to stop 12 hours? Well, he said, "Everybody, as Cardinus Day got up, everyone said, goodbye now, God go with you, good man, take it easy." They went off, and he said, the minute he went out, somebody would say some charitable remark, "Oh, he's gone up to see his brother in the madhouse, or he's going around looking for a bail for his sister who's up in Mountjoy for shoplifting." Or somebody would say, if he was old enough, somebody would say something derogatory about him, that he was an informer during the troubled times. Someone else would say, well, no, I'm not sure whether he was an informant, but let's give him the benefit of the doubt and say he was.
Writer Sean O'Pelon.
I happened to drop into a hostelry here in New York, and I saw over in the corner Brendan Bayon reading a paper. And then Brendan turned to the young lady beside him, and he said, are you in the theater? No, she said, no. And he turned to the man beside him. He said, I see here in the paper something about so-and-so. And the man said, oh, yeah, and turned away. And I could see poor old Brendan thought he was in the Pearl Bar or in Cassidy's Pub or in the Mooney's on the Quays in Dublin, where you merely had to open your mouth and at once you had to shut it because the other fellow wanted to do all the talking. The art of living in Ireland is the art of conversation. It is an art. And you don't notice how good an art it is until you leave it. There's no necessity to leave Dublin to earn a very good living. In fact, it's the best place in which to earn a good living because life is so cheap. Sport is cheap. Fresh air is cheap. Conversation is cheap. Drink is cheap. Idleness, above all, is cheap.
Always has been a gambling country. Aristocrats lost or won estates at little green tables. At roadsides, the poor staked pennies they hardly had. Now passion for chance is harnessed. The sweep, three times a year, has been a worldwide success, though tickets in America must be bought under the table. For the price of a ticket, you can hope eternal. The immense profits support the Irish hospitals, modernize the old ones, provide the new so sorely wanted. Other problems are less easily solved. Unemployment is chronic as surplus farm labor comes to the not yet industrialized cities. The young and healthy emigrate to England and America. The old ones, day after day, wait without hope on the steps, bridges, and street corners that are Dublin's informal outdoor clubs, and pass the days. North of the border is industry the South could use. Partition, another problem, continues a thorn. This reporter talked to Ireland's elder statesman, hero of the fight for freedom, and now President of the Irish Republic, Éamon de Valera.
Mr. President, in 1916, what were your hopes and ambitions for Ireland?
The uprising of 1916 was an assertion in arms of the right of the Irish people to be free. We all felt that it was only in freedom that the aspirations of our people could be achieved. We were conscious that we were an ancient nation, one of the oldest in Europe. We wished to preserve that nation, to maintain its best characteristics, and in that way play a part not merely in improving the material conditions of our people, but also making our contribution to world well-being.
To what extent do you feel that your hopes have been achieved?
Freedom has been secured now over more than 5/6 of the national territory. We confidently hope this will not be long until the whole country is united.
Partitioned by a treaty signed in 1922, 6 counties of Ulster lie to the north, 26 counties of the Republic to the south. Between the two is the border, manned on either side by customs guards as if the people and the land were different. Travelers are stopped by Irish guards as they leave the Republic, by Her Majesty's men a few yards farther on as they enter Ulster. To the tourist, it is an inconvenience. To the patriot, an open wound. And to a segment of the Irish youth, a call to violent action. The outlawed Irish Republican Army, the IRA, stages periodic raids across the border. Blood is spilt, property destroyed, arrests made, the wound irritated. This is Belfast, capital and thriving industrial center of an industrialized Ulster. Busy, noisy, drab. Its shipyards have been the cradle of ocean liners, the Titanic, the Oceanic, the Olympic. Its port, its spinning and weaving sheds, its foundries, tanneries, and breweries keep the Ulsterman well fed, well clothed, well housed, his children sturdy and hopeful. The Ulsterman is descended from Scots and Yorkshiremen, planted by the first Elizabeth on land confiscated from Irish rebels of an earlier day. Yet prior to Cromwell, Ulster was the district most attached to Ireland's Gaelic past. Today it is equally devoted to the crown. The north of Ireland is predominantly Protestant due to gerrymandering at the time of partition. Once in the minority and persecuted by the Catholic majority, the Protestant Ulsterman today lives at peace with his Catholic neighbors. In fact, the Archbishop of Armagh in the north is Catholic primate for all Ireland. Here is the official North of Ireland view on partition.
40 years ago, 26 of the counties of Ireland broke away from Great Britain and formed an independent state. We in the North of Ireland, with a population of 1.5 million people, decided by an overwhelming majority at a great national general election that we would remain within the United Kingdom. We made that decision as a people quite freely and for very definite reasons, reasons that are historical, reasons that are cultural, and reasons that are economic. During the intervening 40 years, we have had general elections here roughly every 4.5 years. And at each one of those freely held democratic elections, the great bulk of our people, majorities of at least 2-1, have decided that we will remain within the United Kingdom, part and parcel of it. And today, despite armed raids on our territory during the past 3.5 winters, in which men have been killed and buildings and property destroyed, our convictions on the matter are as resolute as ever.
Less than 50 miles south, the same language, but the voice and the aspirations are far different. In the south, in the 26 counties of the Republic, both Catholic majority and Protestant minority want a united Ireland. We asked the editor of the leading Protestant newspaper, what about partition?
Ah, now look here, Walter. There I'm unrepentant. I am absolutely, to use the negative term, anti-partitionist, the term that I prefer to use, unionist, in the sense that I want all Ireland to be one country again. I see no hope of its reasonably long survival until that happens. Partition to me has been the biggest political tragedy that my country ever suffered.
CBS News correspondent Alexander Kendrick gets another view from university and Trinity College students.
The border is a complete red herring that's been dragged on every occasion. Everybody's using it as their kind of stepping stone into politics, as you say there, but it is no, at the moment I don't think there's any practical significance at all. The people in the north are happy and the people in the south are happy, except for a few misguided people who I think are misguided.
Yeah, but granted, but I'm saying that that's the system, that to get in you have to use the border.
Yes, yeah, well, it has been made an issue.
Yes, it is an artificial issue, granted.
Yes.
Well, I think the majority of our generation agree that it is a bit of a red herring.
Now, do you personally care whether North and South Ireland become united again?
Well, I care to a certain extent, but I feel that that is a problem that will solve itself, and I feel it shouldn't be regarded as a problem. I think the only problem that exists is that it has been made a problem, and it's an artificial problem. I think time will sort it out. Well, that is Irish politics.
Is there any excuse for the IRA continuing today? Robert Briscoe, 1916 hero, former Dublin mayor.
Absolutely none. Today, IRA are self-selected or self-appointed, who have no authority from the public at large, and in fact represent a very small minority if you take what you might call those who would approve or support these activities. In our time, we were fighting an alien authority, Today, these people are fighting Irishmen, and we want to avoid any further possibility of strife or civil war between Irish, whether they're below the border or above the border.
Mr. Prime Minister, what role does the IRA play in your future plans to achieve unification?
So far as we're concerned, we regard these legal organizations as being not merely a problem of domestic order, which the government has to deal with, but a real threat to the realization of the national aim.
Does the religious issue play any part in maintaining partition, since the six northern counties are predominantly Protestant?
It's certainly a factor. And indeed, the fears of the discrimination against them in the United Ireland is exploited with the Protestant population in the Northeast. But there is no justification for that. Our Constitution provides for full freedom of religion for everybody and prohibits any discrimination against persons on grounds of religion. And the spokesmen of the Protestant Church here have on many occasions testified to the fairness of their treatment by the Irish government.
More than 90% of the Republic is Catholic. Once under persecution, the Irish Catholic was forced to pray in secret. With a change of power, there has been no reciprocal hardness. Members of all faiths have held high office in the government. Protestants, Jews, Catholics, all worship openly and freely. Faith in Catholic Ireland is a burning reality. Mysticism and fervor add a whole other dimension to daily living. Every Sunday in spring and summer, pilgrims travel to Knock in County Mayo. In 1879, the Virgin Mary is said to have appeared here. Mass is celebrated and the sick blessed in an open-air service. Centuries of oppression, much that was Irish was stamped out. The Abbey Theatre, founded to perform Irish drama, glowing with names like Sing, Lord Dunsany, O'Casey, Yeats, helped rekindle Ireland's sense of identity, which erupted finally in the 1916 uprising. But by 1929, legalized censorship had banned some of Ireland's greatest literary men. Only television is immune, because Ireland has none yet. Irish sets catch BBC programs from Ulster. Kendrick asked university students about censorship in the theatre and books.
I think it's the worst sort of censorship, too. It's the censorship, it's a sort of silent censorship. It's not in the theatre, and at least in the cinema and in books, there's an official censorship.
Yes.
The idea of censorship is really to say to keep bad books or evil books, bad books is a very indefinite term, away from people who would make wrong use of them, particularly from adolescents. I think that's dangerous, but I think if people, individuals, want to get books, they'll go out and get them, and that's possible. I don't think that there's nothing all that tight about it.
Just there's no free circulation of them, which is good.
Yes, there is a lot of under-counter sale. In fact, I found quite recently that I could purchase all the copies of Joyce's works here in Dublin, quite easily.
Well, that would be a shame if you couldn't.
Yes, he is officially banned. I mean, that is the point.
There's no censorship at all in the sense of a political or religious censorship. There are boards established by law which supervise printed publications and films, but they're concerned only with indecency, the prevention of the dissemination of indecency.
Do you have to submit your newspaper in galley form or in proofs, or does some member of the censorship board sit here in your office, or how does it operate?
Oh, most certainly not. It doesn't penetrate into life to anything like that extent. No, I think anybody who wishes can submit a copy or a number of copies to the board and say, look here, in your opinion, of this thing to be censored, to be banned. And the board will say yes or no. There's also, of course, an appeal board.
The censorship is something that has been a sore subject. It's been a thorn in the side of all writers and intellectuals in Ireland since it was started in 1929. We've been fighting it strongly, chiefly because it has operated with great stupidity. I don't think there is anybody nowadays, even in Ireland, even among the most zealous, who would deny this. After all, censorship is a very dangerous weapon, and it must be handled with care, like any dangerous weapon, and it has not been up to perhaps 5 or 6, is it more, 7 years ago, when, as a result of a lot of agitation, a more intelligent body of men were appointed to control the publications, books and so on, periodicals, chiefly English, but a lot of paperbacks coming from the United States.
Rich material for the writer, drawn from people scratching for life in a stark land. People of today will tell you that improving living standards and stemming emigration mean more to them than partition or hating the British. The farms are too small to divide, so the younger sons and daughters must go to the cities where the lucky ones find work, or to an alien world across the waters. Money sent home from abroad sustains the old ones, but youth wants more than sustenance.
As far as I can see, we haven't a hope on God's earth of getting a job here. I'm going to spend 4 years at college, and I have to leave. And at the moment, there's no alternative. We haven't the industries to absorb us.
Some people will have to emigrate, because there's no use just hanging here, doing nothing. And you're just draining the country. You're just leading a parasite existence if you are unemployed. Some will have to go so that the others can build up a standard of living.
But what good can it do the country if you emigrate? You said it might do it some good.
For a start off, everybody can't emigrate because they wouldn't get jobs abroad. Most of them would, yes. But our position, if you have a degree, you will get a job abroad without any bother. I think that's very definite. And you're doing no good by staying because you can't get a job, as far as I can see. A small minority will get a job, but the whole lot can't. Whereas if you go away, you will acquire technical knowledge, which you can't get here, and by coming back, you can apply that to Ireland. I think that answers yours.
I agree with you. Patriotism is all right, but you can't eat it.
Once by ship and now by air, the hard fact is that they go, wave after wave of emigrants, and a long wash of sadness is left behind them. Must a country forever be saying goodbye to its sons and daughters, the eager, the promising, the well-equipped? Ireland looks and is working toward the day when she can say to her children, stay, we have use for all of you.
As she gazed on the face she loved so well, all stained with his heart's blood. And when she saw those cruel wounds from whence his blood did flow, sure it made the heather around him look red on the hills of sweet Mayo. She next commenced to dig his grave and lay him down to rest. She planted an evergreen for to blossom on his breast. She next knelt down to kiss his lips but were as cold as stone, saying, goodbye, goodbye, my own true love on the hills of sweet Mayo.
Next week, the Prudential will continue with Chapter 2 of its report on Ireland, the story of Ireland's struggle to emerge as a modern 20th century nation, its hopes for a future more promising than its heroic but strife-ridden past. Next week, Ireland, The Tear and the Smile, Part 2. This is Walter Cronkite reporting for the 20th Century.
It was 1 o'clock in the morning. The platoon was coming down this street when a machine gun opened fire from a high window in that apartment house. A soldier fell just about here. He was the first British soldier killed in action since the army came into Northern Ireland 18 months ago. This morning, troops searched everyone entering and leaving the house. An officer said they believe the machine gun and other firearms are still hidden in the apartments. But the army decided not to launch a full-scale search. It was a weapon search that touched off this week's round of rioting, and once you begin, how far can you take it, and where will it end? The army knows it's no longer dealing with angry crowds of Catholics and Protestants. It's dealing with full-scale, urban guerrilla warfare. The army's likely to continue playing it by ear, getting tough on occasion, returning fire with fire, but generally trying to avoid a clear-cut escalation.
Today's early morning gun battle between British Army soldiers and the Belfast forces of the outlawed Irish Republican Army was the most serious fight between the two groups since 1920. A British soldier was killed here for the first time. Talking with us is a spokesman for the Irish Republican Army, who cannot be seen on camera because it is illegal to belong to that organization.
The British Army came into the area obviously intent on provoking an incident and a confrontation between ourselves and themselves. Possibly it was a strength-finding mission or something similar to that kind. They attacked a fairly large force and they cleared the road for 100 yards. But then there was a little skirmish and the young people of the area and the young men of the area drove them back. And at that stage, the British Army used high-powered SLR rifles into the crowd of young people who were throwing nothing except stones and bottles. At that time, we felt that it was up to us to protect the people of the area, the young people of the area. And we retaliated with hand grenades, concussion bombs, and submachine gun fire. Six soldiers went down from a hand grenade attack, and maybe four or five went down with submachine gun fire.
How can you hope to defeat a 6,000-man, well-trained, highly mobilized, very well-armed fighting force like the British Army when your numbers are much smaller and your weapons so much less powerful?
Well, we must pick our time and our place to attack and to inflict the heaviest casualties as possible upon the British Army. We don't intend to meet them face to face and have a direct confrontation. This would be suicide, and we don't intend to commit suicide at the present time. We feel sure we can defeat them, first of all, by using what any guerrilla organization uses, the element of surprise.
This is the border between the two Irelands, dividing the island north and south. Beyond the mountains of the Mourne is the independent Irish Republic. This side is Northern Ireland, a part of Britain, Ulster. No watchtowers here, no minefields, no barbed wire fences, just an occasional British patrol and tension. For 6 weeks, there has been a ceasefire between the British Army and the Irish Republican Army, the IRA. Catholics and soldiers have stopped shooting each other, but not Protestants and Catholics. The causes of this conflict remain the same. A no man's land still separates the antagonists, and the army still patrols it.
The plain fact is that there is a form of civil war here now, and if it weren't for the British Army, there would be civil war on a scale that would be 17th century in tone and not 20th century.
There is certainly no basis in the claim that the IRA are engineering a civil war. It just isn't on. As I would qualify that by saying that if a civil war is thrust upon us, we will resist, we will fight, and we will win.
Let's get to the real heart of this matter. And the real heart of this matter is, will we maintain the Union? Will we stand for what our fathers stood for? Or will we, for the price of a patched-up peace, submit ourselves to what ultimately will be a Trojan horse that will destroy the people of Northern Ireland?
No compromise, no surrender. The slogans of yesterday still relevant today. And the price of this intransigence, 1,200 violent deaths, and the piecemeal destruction of the towns and cities of Northern Ireland. A permanent truce between the IRA and the British Army will help, but it won't end the troubles. The true battle is between Protestants and Catholics.
If we are getting attacked, the best defense is attack.
The best form of defense is attack.
Today's truce between the soldiers and the IRA is not the first. After every previous truce, the violence has simply escalated. Maybe peace will come to Northern Ireland with a whimper, not a bang. But the truce may also be the prelude to the biggest bang of all, if both sides can find no common ground. What we propose to do tonight is look at two peoples who have learned to live with violence. Two peoples in a state of siege.
This is a CBS News special. A Tale of Two Irelands with CBS News correspondent John Lawrence. A Tale of Two Irelands with CBS News correspondent John Lawrence continues.
The island of Ireland is divided in two parts. The Republic of Ireland in the south. 3 million people, 94% Catholic. Quiet, except on the few occasions when the violence spills over from the north. Northern Ireland, or Ulster, part of Great Britain. 1.5 million people, two-thirds Protestant, one-third Catholic. The major trouble center is the capital of Northern Ireland, Belfast, a city 5 years in the shadow of the gun, where shoppers and soldiers have learned to coexist, where downtown streets are cleared of traffic, not for the convenience of pedestrians, but for their safety. There were more than 3,000 shootings and 3,500 bombing incidents in Northern Ireland last year alone. The turnstiles and barriers keep the car bombers away, but though the searchers deter gunmen and arsonists, they can't look everywhere. Smuggle in a detonator, buy a little fertilizer, sugar, or even grated cheese at the supermarket, add a few chemicals from the drugstore, and one of these shoppers could become a terrorist. In Belfast, there is no perfect sanctuary. The shopper still has to get home safely. Stop violence, the bus slogan says, and when suspicious, dial 999. The country is gone mad, wrote Sean O'Casey in the 1920s. Petrol is their holy water. Their mass is a burning building. British patrols are heaviest in working class neighborhoods. That's still where the shooting and burning start. The Irish Republican Army, the clandestine IRA, fighting to unite all Ireland, sees the soldiers as an army of occupation, the enemy. Catholic neighborhoods, like the Clonard, have long been hostile territory to the patrols. And the Protestants are standing by to fight it out if the army backs down. In Northern Ireland, the Protestants have the jobs, and they'd kill Catholics to keep it that way. a modern industrial society is traveling in reverse, breaking down not just into territories, but into tribes. The Catholic Ardoyne, the Protestant Shankill, the Catholic Falls, Protestant Sandy Row, Catholic Clonard, and Protestant Woodvale. Each tribal compound shielded from its neighbor by a miniature Berlin Wall. But whereas the Berlin Wall separates people against their will, the Belfast Peace Line separates them by choice. The tribes don't want to meet. And behind the walls, only the strong are respected, and only the strong survive. Recently, we crossed into two tribal compounds in Belfast, the Woodvale and the Clonard, to see just how strong the tribes are. 7:30 in the morning. Most of Protestant Woodvale is already at work, but one man in the neighborhood is a little behind schedule. 31-year-old Sammy McCracken is a one-time amateur boxer, now a married man with two children, who has never lived anywhere else but the Woodvale. He and his friends would die to keep Ulster British. By day, Sammy works as an electrician at a building site 20 miles outside Belfast. His 60 workmates are all Protestant. No Catholic would bother to apply or even want to. Working a 6 or 7 day week, Sammy earns $200. His subsidized housing costs him $25 a month rent. He's secure. All of which begins to explain why Sammy McCracken at home is no ordinary electrician. In the Woodvale, meet Colonel McCracken, tribal chief, commander of the WDA, the Woodvale Defense Association. The hoods are to prevent identification by the IRA. The WDA is a semi-legal paramilitary organization formed to defend the Woodvale. But it's more than that. It's an enormous block association with muscle. Sammy commands 300 officers and men, runs three social clubs, and maintains an all-hours citizens' advice bureau at home. A stone's throw from the Woodvale, across the peace line, is the Catholic Clonard. Many of the men here are IRA, either in the internment camps or on the run. So the tribe is held together by the women and whoever is left on the streets. At midday, 21-year-old Des Reynolds walks to the hospital to visit his wife, who's expecting their first child. The streets are almost empty. Army patrols are expected, and the wanderer invites suspicion. Des and his Clonard neighbors see themselves as Irish, not British. The IRA can recruit here, organize operations, and seek sanctuary. As for Des, the British Army knows him well. He is classified as fringe IRA. The reason he's been photographed? Des has just spent 2 years in the Longkesh internment camp for attempting to blow up the Europa Hotel and sniping at British soldiers. He was detained without trial and denies the accusations. During the daytime, Des usually sits around his in-law's home watching television, listening to the news, and waiting for the British Army to leave Northern Ireland. He is confident that when that happens, the Catholic and Protestant working classes will unite.
During the violence, two buildings outside the main...
We talked separately to Sammy and Des to find out whether or not the two adversaries have anything in common.
What does Britain mean to you?
Means a whole lot. Me security for my family. And I won't let anybody take that away from me.
Do you have a job?
I haven't got a job at the minute.
Have you ever had a job?
Not since I left school. I worked for about 2 or 3 months since I left school.
Have you got a home?
I haven't even got a home.
Do you feel safe walking the streets of Belfast?
No. You never know the minute somebody's going to step out, put a gun to your head. Provisional IRA know me. I know they can get me any time. So that's why I don't feel safe.
Why do you keep the shotgun in the corner?
That's for hunting rabbits.
Do you see this as a sectarian conflict? A religious war?
I have nothing against any Catholics. It's against the Republicanism, trying to force their will upon us. In other words, they're going to take away my standard of living. and everything else?
Well, religion plays a big part in my life and all of people's lives. A great lot of people are dying for their faith. Because they're Catholics, they're being shot. And possibly because they're Protestants, they're being shot.
Let us pray for the dead. Pray especially for the dead members of your own families, relatives, friends, all those who have died as a result of violence.
The churches in Ireland have condemned the extremists, but not to the extent of losing the tribal allegiance of their congregations. Church leaders have locked in their flocks for safety, but locked out change. Separate churches, separate schools, separate values, always emphasizing differences, not similarities.
I think what is needed is more dialogue among the Protestant Catholic people. The only difference between the two of us is we have two different ideals. The Protestant man wants to keep a 6-county Ulster, and I want to keep a 32-county Irish Republic. Our children are probably, they don't actually know the difference between Protestants, but they know they're bad, they're wrong, they attack your area. The way I would like to see them growing up is that their enemy will be the British.
Is there an absence of political leadership?
I don't really think the politicians have been any good or helped the people.
Who really governs Northern Ireland today?
No one, as far as I can see.
No one rules Northern Ireland in the present day.
In a political vacuum, the substitute for leadership is rhetoric.
But it is quite clear that the strategy of the Irish Republic's government is the strategy of communism in a guerrilla situation. Take the Vietnam situation. North Vietnam, first of all, said there should be no border. The country should be one. And of course, they should rule it. The South have said the very same thing. The 1937 Constitution claims that they are the governors of this part of Ireland. We would like to tell them they'll never be the governors of this part of Ireland.
How would you describe the IRA?
Most people describe them as scum, you know. They're just people I don't like. I hate them. Fight them till I die.
The aims of the IRA was discovered in a house up the Malone Road, which they were using for cover. The documents were seized and they were put over the television, and you've all seen what their objective was, which was to attack the Protestant working class areas.
Paramilitary units like the Woodvale Defense Association have a vested interest in continuing the fighting. They enjoy their power. In a strange way, the war has transformed what was just another urban slum into a community. But it's fear that holds it together.
On this major road here, this we will set up the evacuation area for the women and children if the trouble does break out. Also, because of the two sides we'll have to cope for, we're going to have the first aid post set up somewhere on the major road here as well, so it's between the two, so you don't have so far to travel with any wounded. As you all know, the way we're fighting at the moment, if and when this trouble breaks out, we hope that all weapons are available. We're hoping for anyway. So you do know in guerrilla warfare how to set your men up in positions, etc., and what way to use the particular weapons that you've got. I would say our main area, but as you know, is the chapel grounds here. Because, as you know, in the last lot of years, this is where all the shooting and that there has come from. They come in from the Ardoyne, in through the chapel grounds, and then they're at a high area here, and they can fire right into our district.
If we are getting attacked, the best defense is attack.
If, for example, your neighbors across the peace line, the Woodvale Defense Association, attacked, would you fight?
Yeah, I personally would fight.
Aren't you, in fact, a kind of sheriff?
Sheriff? Never thought of myself as a sheriff.
What's the toughest punishment you've had to hand out?
bit of a bouncing about, you know. I've never shot anyone.
Have you ever been tortured?
I was tortured by the British Army. They pulled my hair, stuck a knife in my leg, burnt my legs, things like that.
Do you blame the soldiers for torturing you?
No.
It's been said that in Ireland, the pubs know a lot, almost as much as the churches. Sammy's whispered conversations with a colleague might be about military tactics, a bar debt, or a truant schoolboy. Here, the secret is safe. This is a private working man's club. Catholics not welcome. There is security, and it's Sammy's job to maintain it. We asked Sammy's neighbors what kind of man he is. Tough, they said, but fair and honest. He is Woodvale's strongest. So when he sings, everybody listens. Sammy McCracken never seized power. He was elected by a majority of the Woodvale men. But it would take a strong pair of fists, a jail sentence, or an IRA bullet to unseat him now. Besides, Sammy does reflect his community's need for identity. The Woodvale Protestants live in Ireland, but they don't feel Irish. Their patriotism embarrasses the English. Their conservatism embarrasses the politicians. Now, the community, backed by its own defense association and organizations like it all over Belfast, is important.
Sammy McCracken, put your hands together for old Sammy and leave it home.
It's a good feeling. But for the outsider, there's hate here.
Oh, I wish I were in a land of country. Oh, they've not forgotten. Look away, look away, look away. Dixon.
The WDA is only the tip of the Protestant iceberg. There are 15,000 Protestants in similar organizations throughout Ulster. If Ireland was united without their support, these men would be to Ireland what the IRA is to Britain, a guerrilla army. Dixie may be the song of a lost cause in America, but there's a lot of fight left in these Protestants. The battle hymn of the Republic is also a local favorite. Clear that the Woodvale tribe would rather fight than let Ulster go Irish, even though Sammy admits that civil war would solve nothing. There would be no winners, he says, just losers. In the strike of May 1974, the Protestants brought down the Northern Ireland government and did more political damage in 2 weeks than IRA terrorism had done in nearly 5 years. They know they have political power. Their military power would be tested by a withdrawal of the British Army. Maybe nothing would happen. Maybe. Across the peace line, the clonard Catholics marched to a different drummer.
We are the original. We are the Provis and we're proud.
We are the IRA Provisionals, they sing. We are the Provos, and we're proud. This is the Pound Loney Social Club. Here, Dez and his friends keep to themselves. The Clonard community, unlike its Woodvale counterpart, is always under siege. Outside, an army patrol, faces blackened, watches the club through infrared night sights. Inside, the Catholics, though they make no attempt to hide their tribal sympathies, are wary of informers, aware of the dangers of guilt by association. It's not that Dez, just out of the internment camp, isn't popular. It's that to be seen with him is to invite suspicion. No European nation has had its nationalism frustrated so long as Ireland. For centuries, patriotism was all the Irish could have. Generations of devotion to Irish nationhood. It isn't going to disappear in the north just because it's currently impractical. An Irish ballad tells why. Come, all you young rebels, and list while I sing. For the love of one's country is a terrible thing. It banishes fear with the speed of a flame, and it makes us all part of the patriot game.
Come, all young rebels, and list while I sing. For the love of one's country is a beautiful thing. It banishes fear with the speed of a flame, and it makes us all part of the patriot game. My name is O'Hanlon. My age.
At Republican parades and funerals, the IRA men can't show their faces, so the young self-consciously take their place. As one onlooker put it, to hell with the future, long live the past. May God in his mercy look down on Belfast.
Rural England's to blame. And that's why.
Both sides are still far apart, the men that God made mad, for all their wars are merry, and all their songs are sad.
It makes us all part of the patriot game.
No people, wrote the Irish poet Yeats, hate as we do, in whom the past is always alive. The Irish past, more than 1,000 years of foreign invasions and foreign rule, of tragedy and defeat. The English have been fighting the Irish since the 12th century, but it was not until 400 years later, when England became a Protestant kingdom, that the English crown determined to bring the Catholic Irish to heel once and for all. Queen Elizabeth, King James I, and then Cromwell recognized that the only way to control Ireland was to colonize it, with thousands of Protestants brought from Scotland. The battle lines were drawn. Protestants loyal to the crown, Catholics opposed to it. It's been that way ever since. From the very beginning, Britain showed little understanding of Irish problems. The terrible famine of the 1840s proved it. 1 million people died of hunger and disease. Millions more emigrated. To Irishmen, the famine was mass murder. To Englishmen, it was an unfortunate consequence of free enterprise. By the end of the 19th century, Irish demands for a regional parliament, for home rule, could no longer be ignored. But for the Protestant minority, home rule meant Rome rule, a Catholic government led by priests. In the northern province of Ulster, the Protestant stronghold, there were huge demonstrations against it. In 1912, the Protestants began to arm and built an army of 100,000 trained men, the Ulster Volunteer Force. Its slogan, Ulster will fight and Ulster will be right. When the Protestants organized, so did 75,000 of the Catholics. Faced with mounting tension in Ireland and the outbreak of war in Europe, the English postponed home rule. But this time, there were some Catholics who were not to be put off. Home rule was no longer enough. Now they wanted full independence, their own Irish Republic. Easter 1916 was the spark. 1,600 Republicans barricaded themselves into the Dublin General Post Office and other selected buildings and held off the British Army for 7 days. At first, the rebellion attracted little support, but all that changed when the British executed 15 of the leaders and made them martyrs for the Republican cause. In 1919, the Republican political party, Sinn Féin, set up its own independent parliament with a guerrilla army to protect it. The Irish Republican Army, the IRA, was launched against the British Army for the first time. As a compromise, the British offered to partition the island, north and south, with two separate regional parliaments. The Protestant North accepted. The Catholic South did not and fought on. 1921, another compromise. The South was offered dominion status like Australia or Canada. This was acceptable to most Irishmen, but not the IRA, who blew up the Dublin Courts of Justice. There was civil war. But within a year, the fighting was over. The South's connection with Britain was slowly severed altogether. In 1948, full independence was finally achieved. The price of independence was high. The island remained divided. The South became the Republic of Ireland, its capital in Dublin. The North remained British, dominated by Protestants, with the Catholics a minority deprived of political rights. By 1968, the Catholics in the North formed their own civil rights movement to force political change. The violence with which the Protestant police broke up the marches fostered the war mentality that still exists today. It splintered Ulster society into warring tribes. The British Army was called in to protect Catholics against the Protestant backlash, and the presence of British troops on Catholic streets was enough to awaken an enemy who had scarcely existed for 50 years, the IRA. Now, more determined than ever to unite Ireland, whatever the cost. Not to be outdone, the Protestant workers organized their own paramilitary units. The issue of civil rights was buried by the juggernaut of an urban guerrilla struggle. One horror story succeeded another. Catholics shot in Derry on Bloody Sunday. Protestants blown up in Belfast on Bloody Friday. By 1972, Northern Ireland was chaos. The British suspended Ulster's Parliament and imposed direct rule from London through a mediator, William Whitelaw. Whitelaw almost brought the two sides together. At Sunningdale in December 1973, an agreement was hammered out between Catholics and Protestants, with the Dublin government included. The Protestant workers, smelling a sellout, went on strike. Sunningdale collapsed. Now the British government has planned a constitutional convention for this spring, at which Protestants and Catholics in Northern Ireland must plan their own future. Since Ireland was divided in the 1920s, the Catholic South has pressed for reunification of the island. The Protestant North has resisted the idea. When Belfast in the North looks at Dublin in the South, it dislikes what it sees: a backward economy, a government dominated by the church, and a people ready to fight alongside the IRA to recapture the North. The Republic we visited is none of that, though it's easy to see why the myths persist. To Northern Protestants, the Catholic Church seems awesome, threatening, the relationship between church and state too intimate. When Bishop Eamon Casey was consecrated 5 years ago, it was virtually a state occasion. The Prime Minister at the time, Jack Lynch, was there. So was President Eamon de Valera. The Irish Republic, population 3 million, is 94% Catholic. There's a priest, brother, or nun for every 178 Irishmen. Northerners note that the church has been the loudest supporter of the state's laws forbidding divorce and contraception. But these days, the church no longer leads the electorate by the nose, but by the hand. Its political influence is waning, as Bishop Casey points out.
I'm here 5 years. I came here November 1969. I have never once in my 5 years tried to in any way influence the attitude of or the decision of any of the elected people of this class, and I wouldn't dream of doing it.
Could you in good conscience condone the use of contraceptives, of divorce, by people outside the faith?
I would feel that with regard to the use of contraception and the use of divorce, I can't lay down laws and regulations for people who don't share my values. Within the values which I hold and hold very deeply, certainly I could neither condone them nor accept them. But an individual must act according to the manner in which that person's conscience has been formed by his beliefs and by the tradition in which he has grown.
Would you object to a change in the law?
No, I wouldn't. That's for the people to make up their minds about. I won't. I didn't and I won't.
And but I think would that you advise your parishioners to vote against?
Oh, no, against the law on divorce. Personally, I wouldn't know. Again, I would not. This would be a matter for them to decide within their own values. I would not, as bishop, stand up and say, don't vote for this.
The Catholic Church frightens Northerners. But what worries them more is that in a united Ireland, their standard of living would fall. Today, British subsidies keep Northern Ireland afloat. To replace those subsidies, the Republic would have to raise taxes between 25 and 50%. But the standard of living in the South is gradually catching up with the North. Beside the lakes and mountains of Killarney, in the southwest corner of the Republic, we discovered further evidence of Irish prosperity. 32-year-old Jean Fogarty is dispatch manager for a crane factory on the outskirts of town. All over the Republic, Galway, Shannon, Cork, farms are giving way to factories. Like everywhere else, there's unemployment and inflation. But as a member of the European Common Market, the Republic's prospects for economic growth are excellent. The traditional dependence of Irish exports on England is at last below 50%. For the first time since the famine, emigration is declining, and the population is growing again.
A lot of my friends that left and immigrated, my school friends, they've come back now. They're working locally, lots of them. There's no place like Killarney if you want to do a bit of fishing or shooting, or hunting or sport, anything in that line, you know. Generally, everything in that line is here, you know.
Would you like to see a united Ireland?
Well, if it didn't cost me anything, which is probably the wrong thing to say, but I don't think I'll see it. I would like to see it. I would like to see United Ireland.
What price would you be prepared to pay?
Well, I don't think any one life is worth it. I don't think even one life is worth it. It's a shame, you know. Oh, I'd be prepared. I wouldn't be prepared if you're asking me would I be prepared to go up there and do my bit. I don't think I would.
Would you be prepared to pay higher taxes to incorporate Ulster into United Ireland?
I would, I think. I would indeed, yes.
Would you support the IRA?
I would not. I would not indeed.
Do you think people in the Republic are really prepared now to push for a united Ireland?
Yes, I would say they are. I would say they are, you know. I would say there are a lot of good Republicans, if that's the right word, good Republicans in the south of Ireland, you know, and they're pushing hard, you know, and they would fight for it as well, I'd say, you know.
There have always been Irishmen prepared to die for a united Ireland. But today, many are unwilling to give up their new life for an old dream. It's not just complacency that's changed attitudes, but political maturity. The Republic today is a stable democracy. Its government, voted into office by people like the Fogartys, is convinced that reunification cannot be achieved by force. But when Northerners look south, What they see is the IRA and its supporters waiting to march north.
A Tale of Two Irelands with CBS News correspondent John Lawrence continues.
Everyone in Ireland recognizes that most Catholics want the island reunited. Protestant fears are understandable. But most Irishmen want this done peacefully, by political means, and with the North's consent. Only a minority, the IRA and its supporters, still wants to force the North into a united Ireland. In Dublin, we talk to representatives of both viewpoints. Garrett Fitzgerald is Foreign Minister of the Irish Republic. His government echoes moderate Catholic attitudes. On the outskirts of town, we met secretly with David O'Connell, the IRA Chief of Staff. Wanted by police on both sides of the border, O'Connell plans IRA strategy for the North from various hiding places in the South. On separate occasions, we asked both men about the prospects for a united Ireland and the struggle in the North.
What do you see as the essential priorities for a solution to the crisis there?
Well, the essential elements are that the two communities find a way of living and working together and joining together in governing that area. And unless you can get them to work together and get a measure of cooperation between the new regime, whatever it may be, of power sharing in the North and the Republic, it will be very hard to find a solution.
We are fighting to secure the withdrawal of British forces from Ireland. We accept that we have taken a hammering as such over the last number of years. But after all, this is war. We give as good as we get. And on our part, we will continue to fight until the British army is gone.
But what about retaliatory killing in bombing civilian targets in Protestant neighborhoods?
We bomb what you term civilian targets. To
pubs.
Us, we do not bomb pubs. There is an order against our units operating against pubs. If we find that pubs or a pub is frequented by RUC Special Branch British Military, it is a legitimate target. But we have not carried out any bombing operation against a pub simply because it was a Protestant pub or located in a Protestant area.
Isn't it a fact that by shooting people in the knees, by tarring and feathering them, you're using a form of terrorism?
It's a form of punishment which is meted out to those who offend against their own organization. Kneecapping is something which is more relevant to the IRA. We are a guerrilla army and we do have a very strict code of conduct. If that code is violated, then one is subject to punishment. As regards tarring and feathering, I personally would opt any day for tarring and feathering rather than going before a British court and get 15 years.
What do you hope to accomplish by bombing targets in England?
Everything is designed towards forcing the British government to make the declaration that they are leaving this country.
What do you think of the politicians, North and South?
Second to the British government, they have been responsible for the bloodshed which has taken place in this country. The Dublin politicians abdicated their responsibility to the people of Ireland. They claim to uphold a constitution which is supposed to run over the island of Ireland. They do nothing but collaborate with the British, and as such, in our view, they are next to the British as enemies.
The only election the Provisional IRA have ever dared to contest in this island, local elections here a few months ago, they got something like 4% of the votes in the constituencies in which they stood. 4 or 5%. And that's a measure of the degree of support which they have in this part of Ireland. In Northern Ireland, they haven't dared to present themselves in any election.
What about the possibility of civil war?
It is a possibility. If civil war is thrust upon us, we will fight it and win it.
Do you think for a moment that a phased withdrawal of the British Army, the British government from Northern Ireland, would lead to anything but civil war?
I certainly do. I do not accept that it would lead inevitably to civil war. I believe that there is a far better chance that it would lead to an awakening, to the realization of a responsibility on the part of Republicans, Loyalists, Nationalists, Unionists, Catholic, Protestant, that a new era would begin and that we will have to come together. And I think we will prove that we can come together.
to devise institutions of government.
If the British Army and British government withdrew from Northern Ireland without a solution, leaving a vacuum behind them, with the two communities at loggerheads with each other already, in those circumstances, I believe there would be very grave danger of communal strife and civil war on a very large scale, and that is why we wish the British government and army to remain in Northern Ireland until a solution is found, and for as long afterwards as may be necessary, to reach the point where the people of Northern Ireland, by a majority, decide that they wish to join the Republic in a federal United Ireland.
A lot of people in America contribute money to various organizations that support the Republican movement here. Where does the money from America go?
Well, the money is collected purportedly to help the relatives of internees, people who are interned in Northern Ireland or in jail in Northern Ireland, and I'm sure that some of the money does go to that purpose. But I think there's ample evidence that from some, at least of these sources, some of the money goes to other purposes, to buy guns and explosives to help the campaign in Northern Ireland.
Do you care where you get your weapons from?
We don't. If we can take them from the enemy, we take them. If we can buy them, we buy them. We beg, borrow, or steal to get weapons to fight the oppressor.
Do you care where you get your money from?
Not really. We need money, we will procure it by various means.
How long do you think it'll be before you have your United Ireland?
I would make no predictions. I'm past that stage. We work from day to day to bring to bear the greatest amount of pressure on the British government. We may attract them tomorrow. It may take 6 months. It may take 6 years. The overriding theme is we're going to end it, and we will end it this time, irrespective of the price that has to be paid. We do not want to see the next generation go through the concentration camps, have them brutalized by the British soldiers. We have the means, the ability, and the confidence to end it now, once and for all.
I hope that there will in time be a United Ireland. I myself am half Northern Protestant, half Southern Catholic. It would be difficult for me not to feel this to be ultimately one country. But I recognise, as all of us do, that unity can only come about with the consent of a majority in Northern Ireland, and that much would have to be done before that consent could validly be secured.
How long would it take?
Before this all started, many people thought, including many Northern Protestants, that Ireland could be politically reunited within 10 years. I think that few people would think that now, and indeed many would think that it would be decades beyond that. That's a measure of the damage the IRA have done to the cause they purport to serve.
With all the talk of truces and peaces and alliances, the weight of violent history still seems more powerful than the temporary ceasefire that has been patched together. So long as there are armed extremists, Catholic and Protestant, civil war could break out, regardless of what the political leaders of the IRA or the UDA or the British government say. Civil war, if it comes, will erupt spontaneously. We watched it almost happen one day on a street corner in Belfast.
Watch the gunmen, don't worry about the people around up down there. Watch the rooftops, watch the windows.
Wednesday morning, soldiers of the Gloucestershire Regiment cordon off the Catholic New Lodge section after a foot patrol comes under sniper attack. Patrols circle the area, but the sniper is gone. Residents watch the soldiers with growing resentment. The women jeer as the patrol moves out of sight. Across the street, a few Protestants are spotted, and both groups trade insults, gestures, and bottles. A mile away at Clonard Street in the Falls Road, a hijacked truck is set on fire. An army jeep investigates, to a hail of bricks and bottles. Another armored car passes, but doesn't stop. It could be a setup, with a rooftop sniper waiting his chance to pick off a careless soldier. The troops remain undercover, firing warning shots with rubber bullets. When the mood in the city is angry enough, all restraints quickly vanish. It's always the children who notice first. Today, anything goes. A chain reaction is developing. The army continues to circle the Clonard perimeter, trying to discourage a crowd buildup, accidentally trapping a civilian driver in a kind of armor-plated sandwich. Three o'clock, school's out. The tribe gathers. It's playtime. Farther down the Falls Road, a driver leaves his refrigerated truck unattended. An expensive mistake. A second street is blocked. Another insurance claim to be filed. Kids in Belfast get bored quickly. They don't seem to be enjoying themselves, these 13-year-olds going on 30, with manic smiles. Suddenly, the tempo accelerates. An IRA sniper shielded by the crowd opens up on the troops. A soldier scatters the kids with a rubber bullet, and the army advances in strength. A Saracen armored car plows into the barricade. Like a beached whale, the Saracen snags itself on the barricades. Passers-by pay no attention. They've seen it all before. Time to go home. As the junction is cleared, the main body of troops advances in the direction of the lone sniper. Fanning out through the side streets to track him down.
Every one of these. Okay. Section, back onto the road when you've done it. Make a list of those you've done. Well, that's your first job.
The standard IRA tactic is for the gunman to slip into a friendly home, ditch the gun, and duck out the back door and away. The army hopes he hasn't had the time to get clear and may still be inside one of the houses. Known sympathizers and suspects are searched. The crowd doesn't like it. No weapons are found. Back on Clonard Street, the troops make a snatch. A suspect is locked in the armored car. He is not the gunman. The crowd is furious and demands his release. The army ignores them. On the corner, the action slows. It's getting late, 4:30. The small boy who burned the first truck is finally bored with the game and decides to go home for tea to watch the rerun on television. No one was killed. The violence was contained within tribal compounds. No sectarian lines were crossed this time. British Secretary Merlin Rees explains why.
Without the presence of the British Army, there would be a doomsday situation here. And there's no doubt in my mind that the Protestant working class involved in paramilitary forces and the Catholic working class involved in their paramilitary forces, they would meet and there would be, in inverted commas, a doomsday situation. Indeed, some people, but they're always a long way away from here, say, let it happen as the only bloodletting that will get us through the sort of the valley of the shadow out the other side where one can move on to progress. No. I tell you what I think is the only way through, and I don't even mean in the short run. I'm not naive enough to believe that 800 years of Irish history can be exorcised, you know, overnight. It is this. We are going to run a convention. There will be elections for the Irish themselves.
The British government hopes that the political convention this spring will not be deadlocked by Protestant hardliners. If it is, the Catholics will probably conclude that the IRA was right all along, that there can be no political justice for Catholics in Northern Ireland. At that stage, the British government might well wash its hands of Northern Ireland altogether and pull out the troops. And that might lead to the civil war everyone fears. But if the moderates on all sides can succeed in persuading enough voters that gradual political change is to everyone's advantage, then maybe the tale of two Irelands will have a happy ending. Both Irelands have a special appeal, their people a particular charm. But their land has a history and its people a capacity for vengeance and violence that outsiders cannot comprehend. Perhaps it is because of the past, the centuries of conflict, the religious and tribal intrigue, the slogans and songs, the prayers and poems passed down through the generations for 400 years, that Ireland is still divided. For centuries, Ireland has adapted to war. It is centuries overdue for peace. This is John Lawrence. Good night.
A Tale of Two Irelands will continue.
So I'll just live my life.
Since this broadcast was filmed, Woodvale's leading baritone was arrested by the British Army for his involvement in sectarian violence. He is currently interned at Longkesh Prison. His commander, Sammy McCracken, was also interned for 2.5 months, but was released. Since then, Sammy has seemed reluctant to reassume his old role as commander of the WDA. Des Reynolds remains unemployed, but is training to be a professional heavyweight boxer. David O'Connell, prime architect of the current IRA truce, is still at large somewhere in the Irish Republic.
Come all ye young rebels, and list while I sing. For the love of one's country is a beautiful thing. Vanishes fear with the speed of a flame, and it makes us all part of the patriot game.
On a quiet country road today near Dublin, terrorists exploded a 200-pound landmine under a limousine carrying Britain's new ambassador to Ireland, Christopher Ewart Biggs, killing him and a passenger. The ambassador was the first British diplomat assassinated in Ireland since the War of Independence there 55 years ago. Bob Simon reports from Dublin.
There had been four people in the car, the ambassador, his chauffeur, a senior British civil servant normally based in Belfast, and his personal secretary, a woman. The car had just left the ambassador's residence when it ran over a landmine which had been planted 150 yards away. The ambassador and the woman were killed instantly. The civil servant and the chauffeur were injured and rushed to hospital. The car was left lying on its side in a crater 10 feet deep. It was difficult to imagine how anyone could have survived the blast. Within half an hour, roadblocks had been set up all over the country. Police launched the largest manhunt seen in Ireland in recent times. Witnesses said they'd seen two young men armed with rifles running from the scene. It's believed they detonated the mine from the hillside overlooking the road. As soon as word of the murders reached Dublin, the Irish cabinet went into emergency session. The government offered a reward of $36,000 for information leading to the arrest of the killers. There was no official word, but suspicion focused on one of the extremist Republican groups which have been trying to force the British out of Northern Ireland. A number of men, all believed to be members or supporters of the Provisional IRA, were detained in Dublin today and are being questioned by police. This afternoon, Irish Prime Minister Liam Cosgrave addressed the nation on radio and television to condemn the killings.
This atrocity fills all decent Irish people with a sense of shame. The government are determined that all the resources at their disposal will be used to ensure that the perpetrators are brought to justice and face the full rigors of the law.
The dead ambassador, Christopher Ewart Biggs, was 55 years old. He was a career diplomat, a writer, and a former colonel in the British Army. He lost an eye in the Battle of El Alamein. Ewart Biggs took up his post as British ambassador to the Irish Republic less than 2 weeks ago. Bob Simon, CBS News, Dublin.
As the war in Northern Ireland enters its seventh year, there is the melancholy agreement by both sides that this will be the worst summer yet. Last month alone, 39 people were killed, more than in the entire first quarter of this year. So tonight, come back with us to the Northern Irish border town of Strabane, the most blasted and injured, person for person, child for child place in Northern Ireland. Population 10,000, mostly Catholic, but with a strong Protestant community.
So you're in Strabane, with every sign that people live in this place, but little sign of life.
Over here, that's where Mr. Russell ran his drapery shop. And over here, this boarded up building That's where Mr. Shields ran his furniture store for many years. And this bombed-out building here, that was the town hall. And they blew it up, and so the town hall moved. And so they blew it up again. And it moved, and they blew it up again. In all, it was burned down or blown up five times. And across the road, there, that empty space in the corner, that's where the Allied Bank of Ireland stood for many years. And next to it, the Belfast Savings Bank. And down this street, down Main Street, there are a whole series of explosions.
Barely a business left untouched. McMenamin the dentist, his office blown to bits. Messrs. Jones, high fashion frocks for ladies. 10 shops went up in a single blast from a booby-trapped baker's truck. Strabon's two supermarkets, gone without a trace. The Commodore Cinema, closed down for good. The Hong Kong restaurant, Strabon's best Chinese food. The proprietors have left the inscrutable Irish to fight it out among themselves. And both hotels, the Commercial and the Abercorn Square, both wiped out. Strabon is a ghost town, but a ghost town with people. People living behind locked doors and closed curtains. It's not so much threat that you smell in the air as it is a kind of meanness. What started out as a civil rights movement by Catholics 6 years ago has become thuggery by Protestants and Catholics. And so good people stay home. The sociability of the Irish has all but ended in Strabon.
Oh, yeah, boy.
They venture out on Friday only, which, for some reason, has become the shopping day. The Irish hate each other, and both sides now hate the British Army. The British are here to keep them from each other's throats. But it looks like the bad old days of the Black and Tans and the Irish Rebellion.
Here's that bucket in. What are those?
2-3, have you got anything on a Martin O'Kane of 10 the drum roller?
There is no nice way to search someone's grandmother. There is no nice way to search a baby carriage for sticks of gelignite, the favorite explosive of Catholic and Protestant. Men in jack boots and automatic rifles do not really dress up a town until the day you need them. You can't park your car and leave it in the town center anymore, or the army bomb disposal men will tow it away.
One day, someone did park a car here in front of Linton and Robinson, the hardware store in Derry Street. It faces Abercorn Square, the main square of Strabon. Across the square is Dan Kennedy, the chemist, the local drugstore. That's where they shot down Roy Leslie, young police constable. He was only 20. That was the first death in Abercorn Square. The day they parked the car over here, Mrs. Kathleen Jack went to do some shopping at Cathcart. That's that boarded-up shop next to the soldier over there. And she parked her baby carriage in front of it with her son Alan in it. Well, that car there blew up. And so doing, it blew up Michael Bradley's classic bar, filled with people, but remarkably, no one was killed. But one person was killed that day, five-month-old Alan Jack sitting in his baby carriage.
And more were to die for Ireland. Jack Barnhill, the first Northern Irish politician to be killed since 1922, in his home on Bog Road. His house was then blown up over his body. Deaf-mute Eamon McDevitt, killed, possibly mistakenly, by soldiers who thought he had a gun. 24-year-old Bridget Carr, killed in a crossfire between troops and gunmen. Tobias Molloy, shot down during a demonstration. Winston Donnell, of the local militia, killed on duty. He was 22. Eugene Devlin came back from Philadelphia to die in Strabon, killed in a skirmish.
And outside this post office and general store, Sandra and William Bogle and their sons David and Gary and baby Stephen were out shopping. Sandra Bogle will never forget that day.
My husband was in the car with the three children. I was in a few minutes when I looked round. I saw my husband get out of the car. So he came to the door of the shop, and as he went to open the door, a shot rang out that hit my husband. I ran and caught him in my arms, and while I was putting him down on the floor, two other shots rang out, which were very near. I said to my husband, "Are you all right?" "Yes," he says, "I won't leave you." But it was too late. My husband was all dying. He breathed a few seconds and was the end. The doctor came. He just said, "Sorry, this man is dead." My life will never be the same. But caring for the three children keep me going.
How old are you?
I'm 25.
And how has it affected the boys?
David is the worst affected by getting up at night and screaming and shouting. He doesn't realize that I'm there. He seems to relive all over again what he saw that night in Kaleter. I only wish those men could see this child at night while he is screaming and shouting for his daddy and shouting for them not to shoot him. That it would bring them to their senses, that they could understand what they're doing to the lives of people in Northern Ireland.
And they know that their father won't come back.
They know their daddy won't be back, yes. But Gary, he said to me one day, he said, "Mommy," he says, "could daddy not come down from heaven just a wee minute till I see him? I won't keep him, he can go back." He doesn't realize, he's too young, that daddy can't come back.
And the list goes on of planned execution and accidental murder, and the permanently paralyzed, and the anguished, the living. Who do they turn to? Religion? Not really. Religion is responsible for most of the murders. So they come here, to this clinic, the clinic of Dr. Charles Sullivan, the man who knows more about the private terror in Strabane than any other person.
They come into us, they say, they're frightened. First of all, they're frightened. They may have symptoms of which are no relation to fear at all. They may be worried about their children. Children who have normally been gay, out playing with their pals, suddenly become morose, moody, don't want to go out, come home from school and lie sleeping about the house because of lack of sleep the previous night. And if a noise happens, even a car, backfire of a car, that will make them jump and quite often send them off screaming, some of the younger children. This is the biggest problem.
Nightmares?
Nightmares is very bad. Stuttering, as I say before, is one of the worst. Bedwetting getting very, very common.
Has death, normal death, if you can call it that, become confused with violent death?
Very much so, because even a young child recently, I don't know whether I should tell you, a young child recently, when being told that his next door neighbor had died, an old woman of 80, he said, "Who shot her?" That is the type of thing that goes on in this town now. Everybody is thinking in terms of violent death, not natural death. All death is associated with violence, even in the mind of the children.
Strabane, not the prettiest town in Ireland or Ulster or wherever you may think it belongs, does have one claim to international fame. It is embarrassed by the highest unemployment rate in the industrial world. So the men lounge about, existing, just existing on the dole. Days spent in the bars, at night, tempted by the lure of a gun or a few sticks of gelignite, turning some private grudge into an act of political protest.
Turning into Fan Street, meeting our street, very quiet.
These British armored cars are called pigs by the army, by the Irish, and by the children. The machine and the animal instantly vulgarized. And it's almost farcical.
Soldiers with bulletproof vests and automatic rifles seem more vulnerable than babies armed with broken bricks and stones.
None of the older lads are in there, don't they? None of the older lads will be getting back. Just don't go too slow past this lot. There's a bottle.
The children, if they're lucky, will grow old, boasting of their courage. And the soldiers remain silent, a little embarrassed.
All right, drive. Drive on.
If you were just taking snapshots of Strabane, ignoring the background of a score of murders and hundreds of explosions, then it would look perfectly normal. The days begin and they end. The children troop to school in that solemn Irish way that they have, troubles or no troubles. But if you pay a bit more attention, if you listen to the results of a poetry assignment for the 14-year-olds, then you share some of the private moments of adolescent despair.
I've played with them in the street. I've shared my younger years with one. We stayed together and shared our treats. We sang and skipped and had lots of fun. Then, alas, we grew older. The war began and we grew bolder. Now when we meet, we never speak for fear of the boys in the street because she's of the other side.
We look alike, we fight alike, we think alike. There is no difference.
If you're curious or furious that we've not identified who is who, Protestant or Catholic, well, we've held back on purpose. Perhaps the most objective thing we can do is to show two almost identical peoples flailing at each other with one great thing in common, war. War between the poor and the impoverished. And the sectarian part of it, well, there's that bitter Irish joke about some ancient massacre when 3,000 Protestants mercilessly slaughtered 1,000 Catholics. Or was it 3,000 Catholics mercilessly slaughtered 1,000 Protestants? No matter, for it was all done for the love of God. And so, death and life in an Irish town. They die and they are born. Two new faces in the crowd. Two new carriages to be searched. Two new mothers with all the normal anguish of raising children, plus the haunting fear of sudden, meaningless death.
Today, in this sacrament of baptism, we symbolize the fact that before these children were born, before they had done anything right or wrong, God had opened up for them the way of salvation. Marina Mary Graham, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Eric Desmond Anderson, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost.
So Marina Mary and Eric Desmond enter the world of Strabane, free and clear of sin, and committed by history to battle.
BBC Radio News at 10 o'clock, a night of violence in Northern Ireland. Four people were killed in two incidents. Two brothers.
A Roman Catholic woman of 21 has died in Belfast after being shot in the head in the New York.
The bombings go on in Belfast. Today has been the worst series of bombings since Belfast Bloody Friday.
Rescue work went on throughout the night. Not until this morning, when the last bodies were dug out, was the full extent of the disaster known.